More and more, our job is to be curious and to shine the light on insights or human truths that no one's even thinking about.
My name is Merrill Dubrow, CEO of Mark Research. I'm a 35-year veteran of the research and insights community and the host of our podcast, On the Mark. On the Mark is focusing on executives and thought leaders in the world, sharing their insights, strategies, and personal experiences, all of which is unscripted and unrehearsed. I promise this podcast will be filled with tough, pointed questions with real, insightful, and emotional answers. Today's guest is my good friend, Michelle Gansle, Global Lead Insights Transformation Director at Mars. Michelle, welcome to the On the Mark podcast.
Thanks, Merrill.
Well, so listen, we're going to start with this question. I've known you for a few years now. I've seen you at conferences. I've talked to you a bunch on the phone, seen you present at conferences. And I'm going to start with a funny question. You ready?
Okay.
Are you ever in a bad mood? You always seem to have that $5 million smile on your face. You always seem to be upbeat, half glass full type of young lady, and just seem to be positive, oozing with just energy. Do I have that wrong? Like, are you ever in a bad mood?
Well, there's two answers to that. At work, very rarely. I mean, I get paid to talk about gum and candy for a living, so it's hard to find a reason to be in a bad mood. If you ask my boyfriend, he might tell you that I'm often in a bad mood.
Ah, okay. All right. Well, I find that hard to believe. All right. So let's get into it a little bit. I mean, look, gum and candy. I mean, I have a sweet tooth because of my mom, and those are two of my favorite subjects. So I'm a little jealous that you get to work in gum and candy, and anytime you want to send any treats my way, please do it. Tell me a little bit about your job today, and because, listen, I'll be honest with you, Global Lead Insights Transformation Director at Mars. What does that mean, Michelle?
I know, it's almost a self-made job I've got going on, but you know, I think you can share with me that all of us in the industry are grappling with the changes that have been happening for the past several years, especially around research tech, need to move faster. All of that has, I think, been slowest to be, the changes have been slowest to come through CPG. And so I put together a pitch, or what I like to say, a manifesto, like in Jerry Maguire, on how we could do that within Mars. And out of the back of that, I have a job now doing that. So basically internally consulting the company on how we can be more efficient and effective and embrace new technologies and new types of data to be more competitive.
And I appreciate that. Can you give us an example? Give us something that you became more efficient, or a new innovation or a new technology that you implemented in the past 4 or 6 months that's really made a difference in your insights department?
Yeah, there's a lot that is still work in progress, but a couple of quick wins has been we've implemented it for the first time ever enterprise-wide across all of our business segments, subscription to Zappy to be able to turn around automated, you know, concept innovation testing faster. And we've also implemented Street Bees to get to deeper human insight in more real time. And that's just proven to be invaluable, especially now with the whole COVID going on, to allow us to quickly turn around insights to the business.
That's great. And look, truth be told, you know that we're a partner of Zappy's as well. And I'm a huge fan of Ryan Berry and Stevie Phillips and frankly, Julio and just everybody over there. I like what they do and like how they do it. We've had partnerships in the past that, you know, haven't worked. This one with them, with us, really does work. And I'm sure you've had partnerships too in the past that you've worked with vendors that kind of crumbled. I know this one you talk very highly of. Why is it? How do you describe it? What's gone differently on this particular one to make it very successful?
Yeah, if you ask most end-use clients like me, almost everybody talks about relationships. And I think that of course, that's true. But what's their secret sauce is that I think more than any other company I've seen, and I think you guys are probably really close to that as well, is they actually spend a lot of time trying to put themselves in the shoes of their customers. I mean, they were one of the first to do a customer council. They do the Zappy Insiders Club. They're constantly asking for feedback. I just think they understand customer needs, and they're totally willing to pivot. So I think they've pivoted their model like three times in the last 5 years or whatever. So I just am super impressed with their ability to walk the talk and to constantly put themselves in our shoes.
Yeah, no, I agree. I don't want to make this a Zappy or a Vox Poppy. It's the mutual love fest here with Zappy. But there is something I want to talk about, because I think it's important with the changes that COVID has brought to the industry. A couple of weeks ago, you sat in and presented on the virtual summit that Zappy and Vox Poppy did, right? Is that the norm? Obviously, it was very successful. They got a lot of attendees that normally they wouldn't have. Did you like the experience? And are you going to get used to that down the road? Because I know you're a touchy-feely type of presenter like I am. So look at who you're presenting to, and that's a little hard in this situation.
Well, here's my prediction. It's going to be like every time there's a big life event, I think that you're going to see a polarization of there's going to be a whole bunch of free webinars, and then there's going to be fewer but bigger in-person conferences. Because, you know, you've seen, right, in the last few years, how many conferences do you go to or get asked to go to? There's hundreds of them. And so I think what's going to happen is you're never going to replace that ability to meet people face to face and to go and hang out and have a coffee or drink. So there's always going to be a need for that, but maybe not a need for so many of them where it could get replaced in between with these kind of free virtual projects.
Well, and also you won't get as many people to sales pitches and send you emails afterwards and calls and all that. So you get that to go with, right?
Yeah, no, for sure. I thought it was a highly successful event. And just to put in a plug for the Insights Association, the next conference, June 1st and 2nd, I'm co-chairing with Dave Carruthers. And, you know, they really are taking a page off the book of Virtual Insights and implementing a lot of great stuff to make it as interactive as possible.
I didn't, you know, and it's funny, shame on me, Michelle. I pride myself on knowing what's going on in the industry. And I didn't realize you were chairing that or co-chairing that with Dave. Great guy. So let's talk a little bit about what do you hope the attendees come away with? Is there any themes that you really want them to walk away and integrate in their business?
Well, next, this year is really focusing on the theme that's called leveling up. And they're really trying to focus on not just, you know, most researchers, conferences are starting to fall into this pattern of talk about case studies, indirectly sell, you know, supplier stuff, maybe tell thought leadership-y keynote speakers. And this is a lot more focused on, yes, of course, the case studies, but also focus on how can the soft skills stuff. So how can we be better leaders? How can we influence behavior change? So I'm excited about that, because I think that's the kind of stuff that, especially like at the manager to director level, we're all looking for more of that as well, not just another company that's telling me how they did this really great project and were really successful at it.
That's great. So let's turn to COVID-19 a little bit. Obviously, it's changed dramatically lots of companies out there, right? I mean, this pandemic has decimated the travel and tourism industry, forgetting about taking a cruise anytime soon. I think the airports might be the safest place to hang these days, to be honest with you, more so than maybe a grocery store. But how is the pandemic changed your business, as you called it earlier, the gum and candy business?
Well, luckily, you know, we're a portfolio of categories beyond gum and candy. We also own pet care and human food that is considered essential staples, like, you know, Uncle Ben's rice is in our portfolio. So from that, it's really a tale of two cities. You have pet care and human food that are growing as people are stockpiling, and then confectionery that's more of a mixed bag. And so I think it's been really fascinating to watch how categories are impacted and how consumer behavior, shopper behavior is changing, massive acceleration online, you know, people refinding cooking at home again. So that's been, if you take a step out from the personal aspects of it, it's actually quite fascinating. And it's like an insights person dream of gold mine of interesting insights.
You know, it's interesting because I would think that more people with the pandemic are eating pizza. And I'm wondering, because people are nervous, are they eating a little bit? I mean, I frankly, I'll tell you a little secret. I think I'm chewing more gum, and I think I'm eating more candy now and then in the last 2 months than I did prior to the pandemic, you know? And maybe it's a stress thing. Maybe it's a nervous I don't know. Who knows? but it's kind of interesting.
Well, it is a fun fact that ice cream sales are way up. And part of that reason is because if you think about it, ice cream is grounded in a very specific need state that most people eat ice cream as a treat or after a meal, especially after dinner. And because you're stuck at home and not going out to eat, or people are, they're more likely to be like, you know what? I haven't gone out to eat in a week. I deserve a treat. Or I'm stuck in this terrible pandemic and I've been stressed all day. I deserve a treat. And so there definitely is more treating behavior going on, and ice cream is winning out, and to some extent chocolate's winning out. So that's pretty cool to see. And I've seen that myself. I never have ice cream at home, and I probably have also had ice cream and chocolate like every other day.
Well, it's funny. My kids and I had ice cream sundaes the other day, and I brought all the stuff here, and we started with cookies and cream. And I'll tell you a little secret. When I was a kid, I used to take, back in Massachusetts, it was called Fluffernutter, which is basically marshmallow. So most people don't know what that is. So we'd take Fluffernutter and I put it at the bottom of the bowl and I would put ice cream on it, and quickly it would turn the Fluffernutter into taffy. And it's phenomenal with that and ice cream and a little caramel or chocolate sauce and some Jimmies. I know everybody calls them sprinkles, but I'm from Boston. We're going with Jimmies, my show. I get to make the rules. And it's just yummy. And we're doing that like every other day now. So it's funny. I didn't read about the ice cream, but I think it's true. That's great. So are you guys hiring to add to your insights team at Mars?
Right now, no, not hiring. We're just assessing the situation. I think most companies have been in firefighting mode and now in like planning for interim next stage mode. I think most people can agree the next 18 months are going to be uncertain, and then we'll see what the new normal brings. So we're in like planning of what do we do about the next 18 months and how do we plan for a long-term future and what do we think that long-term future is going to look like. So a lot of our energies are around those two areas, but definitely not hiring yet.
Anybody, you don't have to name somebody on your team, but just what makes a great researcher? What makes a great insights professional?
The word researcher feels so 1980s, right? Because I think more and more with the fact that there's access to tools and technology and data everywhere. Our job used to be about doing research, and the value we created was working with companies like Mark and getting data or insights back and delivering that. But I feel like more and more our job is to be curious and to shine the light on insights or human truths that no one's even thinking about. And COVID's been a great opportunity for that, because literally this is so unprecedented that people don't have history really to look at, don't know what to do. And I feel like it's really brought us back to the center of what we do best, which is be curious, connect dots across data and insights, and provide a point of view on the future that's grounded in gut, data, insight, you know, curiosity. So I think curiosity is probably the first thing, ability to connect dots and tell a story.
That's great. And any other qualities to be a great insight professional that come to mind?
I think the best insights professional can manage between right brain and left brain. So can do the like big fluffy understanding of humans, curiosity, trends, future thingies, but also can have some level of ability to deal with data and analytics. More and more, I think successful insights professional also needs to be a high ability to deal with ambiguity and to manage change. Because the amount of change that's being asked of us right now, and maybe that's not just insights, maybe that's everyone. But I feel like that's the topic that keeps coming up more and more, is how do we deal with all this change? I'm not saying you need to learn how to be a data scientist, but you need to be comfortable with having a conversation with a supplier about artificial intelligence and machine learning, right? And that's like way different than 10 years ago.
What would be something, Michelle, that somebody would be surprised to know about you?
Well, this is kind of funny and related to what I emailed you about earlier, but I have a slight obsession with sloths. I don't know. I went to Costa Rica and saw them. I just think they're adorable. And I have like 6 sloth shirts. And right now I'm even wearing a sloth shirt and sloth shoes. So that probably I've never told anyone before other than my friends.
So you're going to laugh. And when you come to Texas, there's a place in Pilot Point, about 45 miles from where I live. And I love animals. And I take my kids up there all the time. You can have a play date with animals. So we've done a play date with a lemur, which was phenomenal. We did a play date with a kangaroo, which was horrible. And we did a playing date with a sloth. True story. And I can text you a picture of it. You know, when you think about a sloth and how slow they move, it's actually about 1/10 of that speed that they really move. Like, I was shocked at how slow they move. Now, when you were in Costa Rica, you saw them in the wild, as did I. Did you go to Guanacaste?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's where it was.
Did you, because they were, when I did zip lining, which was also terrifying, they were everywhere. Did you, and the screaming monkeys too. So you saw them everywhere?
I didn't see them everywhere. I did see them in nature, but I also went to like an ecological sloth zoo.
Oh, okay.
And hung out with, so got to check them out behind bars.
They are great. Did you see the show on Netflix, Tiger King, or no?
Yes, of course. Yes.
Okay, so that is only about 140 miles from me it's actually northeast, and I took my kids there, and I have a video. My daughter played with a liger, which is a cross between a tiger and a lion.
You took your kids there before Tiger King or after Tiger King?
It was way before Tiger King. It was about 3 years ago, and he was there. He's crazy. I mean, he was crazy. We didn't know all the stuff that he was doing clearly, but we had an unbelievable time. It is literally, Michelle, right off the highway. Like, you see this thing and you're like, the sign is just, it's huge, but you can't see anything. It is a half a mile off the highway.
So, fun fact for you, Merrill, you know, I am from Texas and my family, I'm from Corpus Christi, but all my family lives in the Dallas area. So next time I come, I'll have to check that out.
No, you have to come. I want to take you to Pilot Point. Let's go play with the sloth. Seriously. So your family is still all here, Michelle?
I'm not all of them, but some of my siblings are still in Texas, in Dallas area.
Great. All right. Last question. Give me some advice. Any of the listeners who are new to the insights industry or community who are choosing between either going supplier side or client side or anything, any best practices or any recommendations or anything you could tell them as they enter the industry that can be helpful?
Being curious, not just about like people, but being curious around data and technology and how those things come together with human insights is super critical. So, you know, so many people I know, whenever, like, let's say they have a question and they want to figure out a new way to answer it, they don't even know any suppliers to go to because they're not curious enough to go and like go to conferences and check the world out. So my winning strategy is to go to conferences and to be open to talking to suppliers and to hear what's going on so that I understand how the industry is changing as it's changing. So I think my number one advice is be open, be curious, have conversations with peers in the industry, go to conferences, talk to you know, when your people call, answer the phone and find out what's going on.
Oh, that's great, Michelle. Listen, thanks for your time today. This is the On The Mark podcast. My name is Merrill Dubrow. Have a great day.